Hello everyone, I'm Dvir, and I'm happy that after all of the technical problems, we can finally commence with the presentation. My presentation is going to be about the Central African Republic. Is it a developing country? Why is it a developing country? What can the global community and generally people can do to change the situation that is currently there? But before we actually start discussing all of that, I would like to ask you, what do you know about the Central African Republic?
Nothing.
No. Okay.
It's in Africa.
It's a republic.
It's a republic, yes.
It's
yeah. So generally when I started this research, I also didn't know anything about the Central African Republic, and this was one of the reasons that I was curious about learning about this country. For example, the fact is that the disputes and conflicts that we are going to talk about in the Central African Republic are way worse than other disputes that we can see in the headlines every day. So also we can think why we don't see the Central African Republic every day in the headlines, why we don't know what's happening there. It's also one of the questions that I think we should think about. So I think before we actually start talking about development, I want to give you some kind of general background about the country. The Central African Republic is a landlocked country in Central Africa. Its population is around 5 or 6 million. There are no exact statistics. This is like some kind of simplified timeline about the history of the Central African Republic. We can see that it was never an independent country or had any kind of special importance in Africa. In 1885, it became a French colony. The French introduced some kind of somewhat unique system of colonialism, which included privatization of the territory and giving rights to private French companies to exploit the people and the resources that were in the land. So in the time of French colonial rule, 50% of the population died, which is kind of a lot. It's like, it's almost a genocide, even if...
50% of the population, now think about it,
yeah.
Died at the hands of private parties.
Yeah,
private. Some kind of privatization of this kind.
Yeah, exactly. Enforced labor, displacement, and general exploitation of the local populations. 50% of the population dies. So it's not a surprise that there were lots of rebellions in the area. And after some time, it gained autonomy. And in 1960, it gained formal independence. After the transitional government, the first government of the country crashed in a plane crash. A dictator took over with a military coup, and since then the country has been in turmoil until today. In 1965, a new dictator took over, changed the name of the country to the Central African Empire, with a very famous lavish coronation that actually costed 1/3 of the country's GDP, the country's yearly GDP, for the coronation, which was quite famous in the newspapers back then. All through the time, there were a lot of French interventions in the area. It's also a French-speaking country. And in 1979 was actually a military intervention by the French that deposed the emperor and installed the new government. But in 1981, again, the democratic government fell, and since then, there were a lot of changes. In 2012, the conflicts that actually escalated when a new dimension was added, which is the ethnic and religious dimension. While the Islamic population decided to revolt against the Christian majority, set up a militia called the Seleka, entered the capital and deposed the government. Since then, there has been counter-reaction by Christian militias called the Anti-Balaka, which have attacked Muslim villages. Since then, the country has been in constant civil war. There have been four different governments since 2012. There was the first democratic election sponsored by the United Nations, I think, 3 months ago. And right now, violence continues. Sometimes it stops, sometimes it continues.
But may I ask you,
yeah.
The majority of the people, they are Christians or Muslims, or they are divided equally?
85% of the population are Christians, and around 15% are Muslims. But also, we have to note that a lot of the population also has indigenous beliefs. So some still worship the sun and Jesus, for example, so it's things that still exist around them. The Muslim population was repressed, and that's why they started the rebellion. But we can't really say that it actually helped them. Okay, do you have any questions about the history? So I would like us to see some kind of a video to see how the conflict actually looks like. It's a video by the United Nations High Commissioner of Refugees about the humanitarian crisis.
Sorry, I have a question.
Yeah.
Can you say, can you elaborate on the French interventions? Like, how did they intervene and did it do any good?
They can enable editing.
Oh, yeah.
Enable
content. It worked on my computer. The French intervention was basically a military intervention together with some elements of the military. They entered the presidential palace and deposed the president back then. So it was really the most major military intervention, but in a lot of other cases they also intervened by indirect measures. For example, giving aid or withholding aid or generally pressuring the government to change ends. So it was not the only intervention, it was just the biggest one. Okay? Okay.
The Central African Republic remains one of the world's worst humanitarian crises. A fragile peace has taken hold following more than 2 years of war. But instability and outbreaks of violence continue to affect the country and the region.
The
Central African Republic remains one of the world's worst humanitarian crises. A fragile peace has taken hold following more than 2 years of war. But instability and outbreaks of violence continue to affect the country and the region. The conflict has forced hundreds of thousands from their homes. Uncertainty over presidential elections and fears of armed militias have kept most from returning. About 500,000 refugees have fled to neighboring countries. Cameroon, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Chad, the Republic of Congo. Despite lack of funding, humanitarian agencies have been working hard to provide basic necessities such as food, water, shelter, and medical care. The Central African Republic rarely makes headlines. It has become a forgotten crisis. To date, aid agencies have received less than 30% of the funding needed. After so many years of conflict, much more is required. Malnutrition rates remain alarmingly high. Professional counseling and mental health services are urgently needed to help refugees heal and communities reconcile.
C'est nous-mêmes qu'on peut organiser la paix. Parce que si moi, si j'attendais avec les musulmans, ça sera la paix. Mais si les musulmans s'attendaient avec moi, ça sera, on va avoir la paix.
Refugees aren't waiting to rebuild their lives. They're planning for the future. Voting, going to school, finding work and joy where they are. They need peace. They need support.
So this very depressing video actually shows the dire situation in which Central African people are, and it's not a mistake that it's actually called a forgotten crisis, because we really rarely hear about this country in the headlines, a country that more than 10% of the population is actually refugees. So now after we actually saw some background about the country, I want to move to the main subject, which is the development of the country. So this is a sample.
Tell us, how many millions live there, for instance?
Between 5 and 6 million.
5 and 6 million.
Yeah.
In the territory, I mean.
It's pretty big. Okay. It's like 5 times bigger than Israel, something like this. So this is like a sample of some kind of some of the development indicators that we can see. Generally speaking, we can see that the HDI of the country, the human development, is very low. In 2016 was actually the first time that Somalia was not the last country, because the Central African Republic went down and replaced it as the last country in this index. Life expectancy is only 15, which is also pretty low. The GNI is only $350 per capita.
Less than one dollar a day.
Which is extremely low, and also we can notice that it's 40% less than what it was in 2011, before the war started. The tax collection, which is an indicator that I want to use to show how much the government is effective at actually controlling and collecting taxes, is only 5%, meaning only 5% of the GDP of the country goes to tax. In 2012, before the war, it was 10%. Israel, for comparison, is 37%. So you can understand that the government has very little control outside of the capitals and generally enforcing the tax code. The informal sector of the country is more than 90%, because generally it was even in 2011, meaning even before the war, the informal sector was huge. Now it may be even more than that, because a lot of the operations and a lot of the resources are just being exploited and smuggled. The average years of schooling are 5 years, but illiteracy is 40%. And another very strong indicator, in my opinion, is the paved roads, which are only 400 kilometers of paved roads all over the country. It means that almost all of the roads in the country are not paved. There is almost no infrastructure to actually transport things from one village to another, from one city to another. So it's also one of the things that we are going to look at. I also want to say that there are some exceptions. For example, the unemployment is pretty low. It's only 7%, meaning that there is enough work in the country, because the country is extremely rich with natural resources. It has uranium, iron, gold, diamonds, and even oil. And there is a lot of things to work on. It's also fertile. But the point is that with the current situation, work is just not enough to produce enough money, enough resources, enough food to sustain the people in the country. So I think that's the development indicators. Do you have any questions? Some things that... No? Yeah.
What does it mean exactly, informal sector?
It means a sector which is not reported, like illegal mining operations and so on, that don't pay taxes and do not have a permit from the government. So
90% is the worst in the world. I've never heard 90%. I mean, only 10% of people report about their illness. Yeah?
Yeah, we are also going to look what might be the reason for that. I mean, the reason may not only be the war, it may also be lying with the government. We are going to look at it. Okay? So that's basically the development indicator.
So the government gets most of its money from resources.
They
extract some mines, minerals, and they sell it abroad.
Yeah, we are going to look at which sector produce what and what is the size of the sectors. But generally, another important thing to say about the economy of the Central African Republic, that it's considered very dependent on foreign aid and humanitarian aid. They even said that it's like an infusion in an hospital, that it constantly needs humanitarian aid and it cannot rely on its own economy. Okay?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Regarding the GNI, and that include the international support, financial support.
From what I saw, no. Like I didn't check it specifically, but from what I saw, it's
generally the question. Yes, the answer is yes. I mean, GNI, not GNP. GNI it includes all money enters which enters your card.
Ah, okay. 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 So.
And they are still bad.
Yeah.
So after the international support is still 14%.
Yeah, it's extremely low. We are also going to look at where the international supports focus and what actually happens in this subject and different approaches regarding support. Also another thing as a background fact is that the Central African Republic is the world champion of peacekeeping missions. It had the most peacekeeping missions in the world, and right now it has 12,000 foreign soldiers, 10,000 of the African Union and 2,000 French troops, which I think are leaving because of the democratic elections. And it's also something that we are going to discuss. Now, I actually want to see what does these indicators mean in reality. So I brought a video about the problem of infrastructure.
Transport is one of the biggest hurdles Bantu residents say they face today as they try to return to daily life after over a year of conflict and chaos in the Central African Republic. Despite a 10% boost in the country's recently approved national budget from international partners, Bantu residents aren't too hopeful they will see improvements in many basic services.
We have a serious problem because the bus used to go to the center of town and say there's a road problem and the roads are not passable. That's why we're still waiting for an opportunity.
The state descended into chaos in March last year after the Northern Seleka rebels, who were mostly Muslims, seized power and unleashed months of abuses and killings on the mostly Christian South. That government's new budget will draw funds mostly from external donors. Documents show the budget will prioritize security, humanitarian assistance and paying civil servants who have been without salaries for months due to the crisis. Civil servants are not the only ones who say earning a paycheck in Bangui is difficult. Transporters are complaining that their businesses are recording losses.
We've always had this problem in relation to back roads that are hard on our cars, so that we are forced to use the broken bridges since the government has abandoned us. We have to make the journey between the broken bridge and Vigo.
Since the 90s, and the existence of donors from the World Bank especially, commerce was liberalized. Transport is one of the sectors that were liberalized. It's a private sector that runs transportation now. The state, through Sonaka, is the only business of the government that runs buses. But unfortunately, the cars were stolen and trashed. So it's a private sector that's in charge of commerce. And the state is not implicated. And there you have it. You can't talk about bad governance at this level because it's a private sector that's in charge of transportation. Earlier this month, the International Crisis Group published a report advising the Central African Republic's government to prioritize economic revival, fighting corruption and illegal trafficking alongside security. It also pushed for a close partnership between the government and international actors to improve good governance. Maya Mutwa, CCTV.
Okay, so, yeah.
Then I just something that I noticed in the video that was interesting. They're talking about how there's no road, the bridges are broken, but there were two, like a billboard and a big building for cell phone companies. So I just thought it was a really interesting juxtaposition.
Yeah, it's actually ironic, you know, but I think that it actually relates to what people said about the Syrian refugees, because they said, how can it be that the Syrian refugee has an iPhone or a Samsung Galaxy? I think the reason is that when you are at war, the most important thing for you is to be able to communicate with your family. And indeed, the communication sector in the Central African Republic is one of the only things that developed during the civil war in the last few years. It's actually a very interesting subject. Okay, so I think you actually saw the problem of infrastructure. This is the capital. Outside of the city, there are no roads whatsoever, or very dirt roads, which only jeeps can pass. And you have to understand that this kind of problem makes all of the economic development 10 times more difficult, because when you want to build something, you have to bring it with jeeps, you have to take a convoy. It's not something easy that you can just send it by email or something like this. These services just cannot function on this non-existent infrastructure, right? Okay. Any questions? Okay, so we talked about the informal sector, and now it actually looks. So I want to show you another video. Another video that relates the informal sector activity with the current crisis in the country. And now the most undeveloped economy of the Central African Republic actually looks. So, let's see.
International organizations have denounced anti-Balaka control of mine sites, but Christian mining operators like Bartholomew believe they are just reclaiming what they consider to be their rightful property.
Aucun bar n-a tendrat persoanele în familie. Se trebuie într-o protecție. Ne papere, că ne-i rien. Tout ça, là, ça m'appartient. Bon, mais c'est... Le pierre, on les réunit. Parce que c'est moi les choses changées. On les amène en ville. Et je les mets face au patron. Quitte à eux maintenant de faire le prix au patron. Bon, quand le patron, c'est autour, peut-être, si la valeur peut faire, au moins c'est 1 million. 1 million, on divise ça par deux. 500 000, c'est pour les manœuvres. 500 000 fois, c'est pour moi le chef chantier. Oui. Faites beaucoup attention ici. Allez, au boulot, travaillez là. Là, ce sont des praticiens, madame. Les musulmans sont des praticiens, ils vous disent. Maintenant que les musulmans sont partis, on n'a pas besoin de tuer les bœufs, les moutons, de tuer une personne, hein, pour gagner du diamant.
Prior to the conflict, Christians were usually digging in the mines, while Muslims were collecting the diamonds and selling them on the international market, which created inequalities and resentment.
Nayati unaitengi gwi na buba ontro nayati munda guna na leta keke la ite nayati munda guna ni si laswe ituma na wanipi na nayati kondro tisi mbati vive lasu na pati jama yesu asanze di jama su biwara njenza su non sanze ma di jama su biwara su araba onso bafa su kondro na amai pendre avui mbata jina sewa tibi awa njo niko bela te palapona te kondro iwara jama buba ina ndonyo.
Il y a 12 ans. À partir de ce garçon, de cet enfant-ci, on nous disait que c'est nous qui faisions des petits garçons, des enfants soldats, alors que ce n'était pas la rébellion. Nous ne faisons pas la rébellion, c'était un mouvement seulement des anti-Balaka. Et ces petits garçons-ci, ils étaient aussi initiés. On a peur de les perdre, qu'ils soient d'être tués par les Séléka, abattre par les Séléka. Et c'était comme ça que eux aussi, ils étaient initiés, ils ont pris du remède. On leur donnait des remèdes, ils ont bu des remèdes pour ne pas qu'ils soient atteints de barbares et de mourir. Mais c'est comme ça pour un petit Africain, Centrafricain même.
Now richer than before the conflict, it is hard to see how Christians like Bartholomew could return to working alongside Muslims.
Any questions? No? Okay. So this is just a small part of actually a very interesting movie by Vice News about the conflict in the Central African Republic and the mining operations. And I think that you can see how it works, completely primitive operation, like there is no tool, they don't actually don't actually in any way change the diamond or shape the diamonds. They just take them as is and immediately sell them abroad in the international market. And also those kind of operations are part of the informal economy that is controlled by militias. So
the government is not involved in such a mine.
No, it's not involved at all. These are militias that control many parts of the country. And they set up their own rules, their own taxes, and their own systems.
Neoliberal
system. Yeah, neoliberal. So I think it's quite interesting. Okay, so after we saw a little bit the situation, some videos about it, can you tell me what are the similarities and differences between the Central African Republic and other developing countries? Is there anything special about the country that you notice? No? Okay, yeah.
Weak institutions.
Weak institutions.
No, I mean, if the government is not involved, it seems that the government doesn't control it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Okay. Anyone else? No? Okay.
Informal sector.
Informal sector.
Bad infrastructure.
Bad infrastructure. Other things?
You have also the civil strife is not presenting every country.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What about the women in this country? I haven't seen anywhere in the videos.
Yeah, like generally when it's a time of civil war and the economy is very based on physical labor, so women have way less opportunities. But actually, it's also important to say that the temporary president of the country until the elections 3 months ago, she was a woman, which was one of the only African leaders at the time. So it's so I don't know what it means about the women's status in the Central African Republic, but. But it's important to know. So yes, we actually can see a lot of things that are typical for developing countries, but we can also see, for example, the fact that the country is extremely rich with natural resources is not something typical for developing countries. Yeah.
But if developing countries have natural resources, the fact that it sounded in the video like the natural resources and the way that they were dealt with had something to do with the civil strife. So this is an example of the resource curse, which if you're going to be developing country with natural resources.
Yeah, like I totally agree with you. I just mean that that for even developing countries that are developing countries, they are not developed countries, but they have such an amount of natural resources, you would expect at least a tiny part of it to leak into rebuilding infrastructure or some kind of institutions. But in the Central African Republic, I think it's one of the most extreme cases where it just never happened, you know? All over the years that these resources were exploited, it never happened. And some of the resources, like uranium, for example, are not even exploited because they don't have the technology to mine it. So
I think also that once you have resources, in most cases, so we assume that government would extract these resources and have some money, but if indeed many militias extract these resources, so the government still may well be very poor. I mean, everyone who would get the resources would be rich, but the government perhaps not.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very big contrast that we see here, and I think it's also unique in some way. Okay, so after we looked at the general situation in the country, the development indicators, I also want to look what is the trade policy of the country. Even though the institutions don't always function, I want to see what the government did try to do. So first of all, the government is a member of CEMAC, which is the Economic Union of Central African Countries. It's a union, like it's a regional trade agreement that allows them to lower tariffs and give preferential policies towards each other. But despite being a member of this bloc, the Central African Republic has requested a waiver in 2014 on its commitment because of their lack of revenue and got a waiver on their commitment. So the situation was so bad that they actually let them enjoy the privileges without following the duties of being a member of this bloc. The average tariff rate in the country is 18.2%, but the agricultural sector, which I think is the most important in such a country, one of the most important, is 23%, which is generally high tariffs, But it also doesn't represent some kind of completely protectionist economy. So we can say it's some kind of a mixed policy, except one sector, the sugar producers, which I read that the government has stalled and blocked imports of sugar because it's a sector that was close to the government before the rebellion. So it's also something to know that protectionism and as a result of corruption also existed there all over the last years. Generally, there are no restrictions on trade, but rebels restrict them in the areas that they control. Sometimes they let trade pass, sometimes they don't. The taxes always change. It depends on the militia. They benefit from the program by the European Union of everything but arms. I don't think it helps them too much because it's very hard even to transport the products out until the European Union. And I also read the WTO periodical review from 2007, which actually checked the situation of the country. It was before the war, but most of the things that they said then are still valid right now. They said that the main problems are really lack of infrastructure and security, and that that none of the local companies have used the preferential status that they get from CIMAC, which actually shows how poor the access to trade is. And they also said that the fact that the country is poor makes them unable to maintain an office in Geneva, so they can't really participate in the discussions of the WTO and take part of the global trade arena, which we can call it.
If you remember what we talked about, negotiation resources, poor countries are not represented like the EU, Germany, or Canada, mm-hmm. or Israel. Yeah? Mm-hmm. They don't have a representative in Geneva at all.
At all. They don't maintain an office, and generally very little embassies also around the world. So it's also one of the problems that the WTO noted. And the government statement to the WTO back then, they said that their main priorities are to liberalize the economy and facilitate rapid development of three sectors, which are agricultural, mining, and forestry. So generally, we can say that the government, at least according to the statement, was open to liberalization, to the neoliberal approach. But we don't know how much they could really enforce such an approach or such a policy because of the security situation. These are the trade partners of the Central African Republic. We can see that France takes a big place, maybe because of their proximity, same language and so on. Maybe also because there are a lot of programs of cooperation because they used to be a colony of France. In the import section, so we can see that they mostly This is the export section. They mostly export to the European Union, but also to neighboring countries. I think it's quite the same in the imports and the exports. But if you look at the size of both of these parts, you can see how small it is. I mean, this is the exports, so $149 million of legitimate exports per year. Just to give you a sense of how small it is, it's 0.2% of the exports of Israel for the same year. Meaning Israel exported 500 times more than the Central African Republic in 2016, which is quite a lot. Any questions?
But again, I think there is here also a question of reported trade and unreported trade. I mean, such guy that we have seen on the screen, perhaps he exports some diamonds and it would not be registered, no?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. I mean, I think they talked a lot about border smuggling because also the countries near the Central African Republic are also relatively weak countries. I mean, they are not neighbors of Europe or something like this. But the point is that this is the only trade that the government and the infrastructure can actually benefit from because they cannot really benefit from unreported trade. That's a problem.
Really an extreme case.
So now I would like to talk a little bit about the different approaches that I think can be valid to our situation, the approaches that we studied about in the class. I think the first one, and maybe even the main one, that comes out of all of this dire picture is the neo-institutional approach. I mean, there are generally no institutions. If there were no institutions, So it's very hard to actually facilitate development. First of all, there is no protection of private property, so the risk is too high. Nobody is going to invest in the Central African Republic when there is no government, no police. One of the problems of the international community, in my opinion, regarding this approach, is that the international community always replaced on changing this one brutal dictator with another brutal dictator, or actually conducting free elections. But all of those instant solutions didn't really change the situation. They didn't really create some kind of magical good governance out of nowhere. And today it's the same, because even today there is order and employment and peace only where the peacekeeping forces are. And once they leave a city, immediately anarchy returns. That's the situation. So I think that's the main approach that explains all of the what we see. But on the other end, like, there are some things that are not dependent on institutions. For example, the fact that the country is landlocked. So it was always a huge problem for them how to transport things. So even if there will be good institutions, it may still pose a problem. And another thing is the ethnic tensions, which are also, I'm not sure that good institution would necessarily be able to put it down. You know, I mean, something real that is happening. You understand? What do you think? Do you think it explains it? No? Yes? Okay.
If you have significant ethnic tensions and wars, then it would undermine institutional capacity. It's one of the reasons.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I just mean that even if you would create some of the good institutions, maybe they would never be able to really enforce order, even if the government is good. You understand what I mean?
Yes.
I mean, I agree with you. I think it explains it pretty good, but some things don't change, you know?
I know that there is something in addition to ethnic clashes, because you said that more than 80% of the population, they are Christians.
Yeah.
So let's say that the Muslims, they don't comply with any law. Still, you have the vast majority of people that theoretically may be more institutionalist. Yeah, outside of the informal market, but even that doesn't.
Yeah, you're right. There is a lot to improve in the point of institutions, and I also wanted to actually give you some kind of graphical image of how it looks in the last 3-4 weeks. Those are articles only from the last 3-4 weeks, showing us some signs of what's happening in this institutional approach. So generally you can see some kind of positive signs. For example, the Central African Republic holds unprecedented disarmament talks with rebel groups. 13 military groups met together to discuss disarmament. You can see that the US recognizes the new government and gives them non-lethal aid, which is also some kind of development. You can see that, for example, the World Bank has a really nice program of actually giving money to reintegration of former soldiers. But also you can see some negative signs. I mean, you can see that there the worst violence in years. It happened 3 weeks ago when there was a big massacre of 100 Central African soldiers of the new army. And you can also see, and I think it's very important, that the Ugandan military, which helped the new government, withdraws right now because they say that the mission was accomplished. Because peacekeeping missions are very expensive, and it's very easy to say that the mission was accomplished and just leave. So you can see some kind of mixed signals coming from all of it. I don't know what will happen in the future, but I think it's pretty interesting. Do we have time?
We have to make a break. And we will continue without PowerPoint. So you want more 3 minutes, or we will have a break now?
Break.
Huh?
Okay. Half second.
Okay. Let's take a break of 15 minutes, and then getting back to our room 404. I apologize, but...
כן, אפשר. יש עוד תרשים או שניים, אבל זה לא נראה לי הכי קריטי בעולם.
באמת שיחסית למצב הסתדרנו טוב.
תודה רבה.
תודה רבה, אני מצטער על הבלגן, זה מהו
So, unfortunately, there were some technical problems with the recording because we had to move a class. So I will try to sum up what happened afterwards. Unfortunately, we had a lot of interesting discussions in the class, which I will not be able to repeat. But what we basically discussed is the dependency approach regarding the Central African Republic. We have discussed how colonialist powers have exploited over and over again the resources and the political power of the Central African Republic, even when it became a fiction, even when there were peacekeeping interventions, they mostly intervened on behalf of the side that they thought that could serve their interest best, with the main one to blame, France. And we have discussed a lot about what is the right mode of peacekeeping intervention. Is peacekeeping intervention even a good thing? Is there any possibility to really change the culture of such an undeveloped country and transform it into something better? We have also shown that there is a huge trade deficit also as a result of the lack of industry and the lack of development, which causes the Central African Republic to export mostly the most basic primary products like wood, and import on the other end everything else that they need, including medical supplies and a lot of telecommunication sector, as well as a big portion of military equipment, roughly 30% of the import section for 2016. So that's what we have discussed. It was actually quite interesting, and the professor Moshe Hirsch also brought some of his views about it, and give some kind of examples for failures and successes in regards to interventions. Afterwards, we've talked a little bit about the neoliberal approach, the fact that the Central African Republic has very high taxes and a very complicated trade code, which might make the governance of the country way more difficult. We said that maybe one of the possible solutions to the situation is to lower taxes, because when the personal tax is 50% in a non-functioning country, nobody is going to pay. But if the personal tax would be 10%, maybe it would even increase the revenue of the government in the long term, and would allow them to have some more cash to protect security and property rights and so on. But we mostly agree that the institutional approach is the best, is the approach that most fits the case that we talked about. Afterwards, we have discussed a little bit other approaches, like a Keynesianist approach, which the World Bank takes into action in the country. They have several programs that are about pumping money into the economy, about initiating simple labor such as building bridges, digging wells, building roads and so on, mostly investing in infrastructure. And we said it can be a good idea. The main problem is how much time will they have to continue this project until the money dries up and the project ends, because if the project just goes on for few months, it's not really going to be a long-term solution for this country. Afterwards, we talked a little bit about conclusions. We said that the Central African Republic is really a fiction. It's a fiction country. And as such, we have to treat it accordingly. We cannot treat it like some kind of a developed country or some kind of a country that really functions, but it just doesn't. Maybe the solution is to ignore the country when it comes to foreign direct investment, and talk directly with the militias and the rebels that control in practice many parts of the country. Maybe the real solution is to just try to divide it among its neighbors. But then we talked about the possible problems that may arise, such as regional wars, such as another exploitation of the native population, and so on. And maybe we just have to really think about how much money would it take to really bring the Central African Republic into a place where it could be self-sufficient, because it's one of the rare cases where there is a huge contrast between the amount of resources and the amount of possibilities and potential in the economy of a country towards reality. That reality is actually that nothing happens, nothing really changes. The economy remains in a very low level of subsistence, mining, and so on. Actually, that's what we talked about. Afterwards, we had some kind of discussions and tips about how to do a presentation generally. This video is mostly for myself, to give some feedback to myself. But if anyone actually found it interesting and wants to learn more, you can of course send me your questions, and thanks for watching.